Washington's F Street looks like Hollywood or Broadway on an opening night as people arrive for a special benefit preview for the Stay in School Fun Drive. The feature film is Universal's Charade, starring Cary Grant and Audrey Hepburn. This is Sergeant Shriver, sister of the President and wife of the Peace Corps Director, arrives, as do the Attorney General and Mrs. Robert Kennedy. She is co-chairman of the Benefit Committee, of which the First Lady is honorary chairman. The Vice President and Lady Bird Johnson are among the many leaders of the Capitol's social and political life attending the performance, whose proceeds will help keep dropouts in school.
Well, I remember the opening very well in the Lowe's Capitol downtown, which opened as Lowe's Fox on F Street. And they had a feature film, they had a newsreel, they had an organ interlude, and then they had an orchestra come up out of the pit and play, and then they had four or five variety acts on the stage. And it, the whole act of show business and putting it on was very intriguing to me. And if you got in during the weekdays before 1 o'clock, it was 25 cents for the whole 2.5 hour show, 25 cents. Of course, at night it wasn't much more either. It was about a dollar and a half in the evening. There's a book written by Ben Hall that says that the ordinary housewife, to get away from her drudgery of her day, of her routine with the children and the household, would go downtown to the local theater of the 20s and 30s, and for 25 cents or more, she could be ushered in by a tall blonde with a gold epaulets on his shoulders and a little flashlight and ushered to her seat, and she felt like she was in heaven, sitting there in this beautiful thing with the rugs this thick and the chandeliers and the picture on the screen with then the favorites of the day, whether it was Gloria Swanson or whomever, and they just made her feel like she was a queen for a day to sit in this beautiful movie palace. So they were made purposely a little bit garish just to attract the people and make them feel like they were out of this world in another location entirely.
About 1919, I worked on 9th Street, which was the center of the moving picture theaters at that time. At that time, there was at least from Pennsylvania Avenue up to G Street, there was about 10 moving picture houses. I worked from 10 o'clock in the morning to 11 o'clock at night with a brief time off for lunch and a brief time off for dinner. But it was very enthusiastic work for me, and I didn't mind the hours because I was seeing movies all the time. There's not the prestige, I don't believe there's a prestige of going to a complex theater where they have three or six or multiple screens. It's not like going to a palace or even the Capitol or Keys or Warner's or Columbia or the Metropolitan, which were all downtown Washington. When you went to one of those shows, you could tell somebody you were downtown, you'd seen a good show, you'd been to a good movie. Those movies were built to make you comfortable, to bring you up to date on conveniences, to bring you up on beauty of a building.
It was a trip to go out of an evening and see a show. In those days, downtown was still downtown, and before the show, they could have a nice meal, or after the show, a supper, and they would walk up and down F Street looking in the department store windows. It was quite an evening. It wasn't just walking into a little small room with a screen at one end, and that, for $5, that was the movie. In those days, they were theaters. They were presentation houses. Everything was perfect. Curtains opening and closing. Polite ushers. I don't know when the last time I saw one of those. At that point, nationally, the pictures were no longer playing exclusive in any one theater. They were experimenting with three theaters first run. Four theaters, five theaters, six theaters. And it just gradually, from 68 onwards, that became the new policy, and an exclusive first-run theater really couldn't sustain anything but the greatest films. And they weren't about to put them in downtown Washington because of the riots and also because of the popularity of the suburban theaters in the shopping center. That's where the people were.
Well, this is the site of the old Hyatt Roof Theater, which I opened up in 1939, 2 days before Thanksgiving. I'll never forget it. They were lined up for about a block and a half to get into the place. The theater itself is located right along here, about three-fourths of the way down to the parking lot, And of course, we had adequate parking in the back there. In front, we had a double lawn with a concrete sidewalk leading to the front of the theater. And little by little, the attendance went down. So finally, they sold the entire property to Lustein Chevrolet. And you see what he did to it. Well, the Belfort Drive-In, I never had been in a drive-in theater in my life. So Sidney Lust decided to build one then. After the war, when he was able to get material, everything, he had a thing about me opening all the new theaters. So I had to go out there. I was worried. I thought, oh my gosh, what am I going to do out there? I've never been inside one, be nothing but drunks, accidents, so and so. After I'd been there about a month, I didn't want to go back inside anymore. I loved it. We had a wonderful playground there. We had a little merry-go-round, had a boat ride, believe it or not. We had a great big pool fixed up, motorized boat ride. We had a little train ride there, swings, slides, and it was wonderful. I used to love Saturday with the kids. In the front row, the Cap Pistols, when the Indians come all over the horizon, you know, and Custer, the others, besieged by the Indians, the kid be shooting the Cap Pistols at them, you know, and so forth and so on. I used to love that. And I'd be backstage very often, waiting to put in my contest. I always had a contest here on Saturday, pie eating, you name it, we had it, see. And I could watch the kids from backstage riding with the cavalry, you know, the hill scene, shooting their pistols, you know. It was great.
As a child growing up, going to the old Hyattsville Theater in Hyattsville, it was just, for me, it was just a terrific experience. I loved every minute of it. The theater had a certain personality all of its own. It was very ornate. All your friends were there on Saturday afternoon. The movies were the horror pictures of the 1950s, science fiction movies, and it was just a thrill for me. And one day I wanted to have my own theater, and I did. Well, what would happen was the girls in the audience would scream at the horror movies, and that just made the kids even, it scared me because they screamed so loud. That and the horror picture, it was really a mess at times, but it was fun. It really was. Kids today, they just don't have that. And I think they're really missing a whole lot. We didn't change the front on the flower when we twinned that. It's still exactly like it was when it opened, the marquee and the name sign. I've kept all the neon, something that very few people will do today. And the new theaters, they don't even use neon anymore. It's too expensive, but nothing looks better to me than a theater that has a neon sign. I'm sorry.
What's changed is that in the 1920s, you went to the movies, kind of like we watch TV today. It really didn't matter kind of what was there. The theater drew in, and it was a whole package of interesting things to do. And you also remember that these theaters were also next to shopping, the best stores and near the banks. They were part of the community you went to. Today, you go to the movie. You know, the movie's advertised on television or in the paper. You get interested in that. You go to the movie, and most people don't even, you know, could hardly describe, let alone where the movie is and, you know, what the theater's like, unless it's crowded or...
Did it close as? Was it the Sylvan?
The Sylvan, yeah.
It's over there on the left, next to Bloomingdale, that Bloomingdale store.
Bloomingdale liquor store.
Yeah, yeah. Centered
well,
around
the back of a
Street.
Theater? Which theater is that? Yeah, it's got a big stage.
Is that the Howard?
That must be.
Never saw the back of it.
Yeah, it's got a big stage, doesn't it?
Dunbar is up here. It's still here. Look at that. The sign is up. Huh. It was a building built by the... And this is a bad area.
Yeah, this is not too... Ooh.
Where this parking lot is on the left. My gosh, they tore down all those other buildings.
Jeez.
Look at that. Jeez. Mm. Where this parking lot is was the Rialto Theater, and it was... Everybody said it was built too far uptown, and it never did good business. Well, where the heck is the Booker T? Is that gone, or is that...
I think it's down there.
I thought the Booker T was... I thought that was...
I thought they were both in the same block.
I don't know. One of the really exciting things for me about theater research is to find the names of these theaters and go down the street to look for them, and usually it happens in some, perhaps an out-of-the-way area. You drive down the street and you see this building that looks like you're in a time warp of some sort, that the building hasn't changed since 1915. And it's really exciting to see this building. There are a couple in Washington, well, I guess one in Washington, the Liberty Theater on North Capitol Street that looks like that. In the basement of the Tivoli Theater, when we went in one time, there had been a water main break, and the water was about 4 inches deep down there. We got down there and we heard a hissing, and it was gas escaping from a gas main. We got out of there very fast.
Washington defies the usual stereotypes. There were a few picture palaces built here, but they were typically built very late, and the reason was because when the rest of the country was doing poorly, the Great Depression, Washington was doing real well. So we have a lot of interesting deco theaters, but very few other cities have them because nobody was building anything in 1930 to 1939. But then the irony is that with a lot of, you know, I mean, the Center for Preservation of Architecture and all of this business is here, yet they've torn more theaters down here than almost any city that I can think of this size. I mean, Milwaukee, where I used to live, had three times as many more interesting theaters left than Washington does. I think it's because the federal government has such an impact, and in the 50s there was this pattern of urban renewal, which in some cities that had a lot of money, urban renewal very quickly, and that really hurt the Picture Palace a lot. The cities that didn't have so much money, Milwaukee, for example, waited for years, and finally, by the time they got to around to tearing some of them down, people didn't want them torn down anymore. But in Washington, they tore them down real early.
The city owns the Tivoli. It was purchased as a part of an urban renewal project where the city was coming in after the riots and buying up parcels of land in the late 60s and early 70s with the idea that they were going to come in and do the typical urban renewal of tear everything down, build a big hole, and build something new. And unfortunately, the monies ran out for the city. They were not able to carry through with the things that they had planned in the early 70s. And the delays and the delays and the delays gave us enough time to move into the community, get ourselves established, and to begin Save the Tivoli.
The owner of the Tivoli, Harry Crandall, had a very bad experience with another theater that he owned over at 18th and Columbia Road, which was the Knickerbocker. In the winter of, I believe, 1921 or 22, there was a tremendous snowstorm, and the dead weight of the snow caused a roof collapse of the Knickerbocker, and I think nearly 100 people were killed. And at that time, the Tivoli was in its early design phases, and Mr. Crandall didn't want to make the same mistake with the Tivoli that he experienced with the Knickerbocker. And he hired Thomas Lamb to come in and revamp the designs for the Tivoli, building a tremendous factor of safety in the truss design for the roof system. And so the building is extremely structurally sound, and it's not about to fall down in any shape or form. Of course, a wrecking ball could take it down. It would be doing a disservice to the community to tear the Tivoli down and implement the development plans as it was originally proposed, because you lose so much of the economic development potential. And I think that, when the original concept for redevelopment along this entire 14th Street corridor was first envisioned immediately after the riots, it was really done in the context of urban renewal. In other words, you tear it down and you start anew. Now, we've moved from 1968 to the mid-1980s. There are other redevelopment tools that can be put into place to encourage redevelopment, one of those being using historic tax credits to rehabilitate old buildings.
We love it. I wish the people would come and see it. The walls are all brocade. It's an old-fashioned theater. We love the people who come here. The people who come here really appreciate the older theater. We took a survey, and many of them wrote and said, don't change anything, leave it the way it is. And they wrote that they love it, and it reminds them of their childhood, a lot of them, when they were younger. That, to make ends meet, we have a tuxedo rental, Damascus formal wear.
That's my son and the daughter-in-law. She works in the theater.
Belongs to our daughter-in-law, but we help her. And it helps them out. And then in the summertime, they have a produce stand, and there's fresh corn every day. We don't sell any day-old corn. It's picked fresh.
They even have a few regulars that come in for popcorn only, too.
Yeah, we have people come in the evening. They some one man comes and buys 5 boxes of popcorn about every evening. Another man comes and buys 3.
Yeah.
And they like our butter, our popcorn.
Well, it was. I think it gradually progressed from good to bad to bad, to coin a phrase. And I'll tell you frankly, while I did not show any pornographic pictures on the palace screen, I was certainly surprised that I ever showed nude pictures on the palace screen. I never thought I would live that long, especially at the Palace Theater, and show nude scenes on the screen.
In the old Earl Theater, which is now the Warner, every year in the summer, and he would come for about a week or two, not just 1 week, Red Skelton would come there and appear on the stage. And then at the end of the stage performance, he'd jump down off the stage and run out in the lobby and shake hands with everybody as we're leaving the theater. And I remember shaking his hand very well down. That was the old Earl Theater. And they had a well-known what's called green room backstage at the Earl. And I used to go back there as a young boy, and when they'd come off the stage, I'd meet them and have them sign a picture, Betty Davis and Loretta Young and all those stars of that era. So it was an era that's passed now. It'll never come back, never. That'll never reappear again, that scene.
I don't think the single screen theater has got a very good future. I just think it's gonna be harder and harder, and a lot of the theaters that are standing now are being operated under old leases where the rent's not too bad, but when those leases come up and the landlords want the rent that everybody else is paying, it's gonna be curtains.
Well, Keith's now, the old Ebbett restaurant, the entrance to old Ebbett restaurant is the original entrance of Keith's. It's been restored exactly the way it was when Keith's opened back in 1912, thereabouts. But there's nothing left of the theater. The only thing they preserved was the facade of the building. The theater was just completely gutted, nothing. All the way down below the basement, gone were the Turkish baths, the barber shop, the large lounge, the oak paneling and the tile floor, which was there till the end but hadn't been used in 20 years or more. It was sad to see it happen. It's like losing an old friend. And there's something crude and see that ball whamming into the building, you know, and you see the seats were still in there. You see the seats going this way and that way, and the balcony start to sag. But I think the saddest thing of all was that they finally, the asbestos curtain did come down. We had been trying to get it down to see what it looked like all the time we were running the theater, and I'm sure everybody else did before us. But it had been wedged in an upright position. Well, they got it down. It wasn't that spectacular, but it was a faded violet cloth on the front of the asbestos. Usually they were painted some romantic scene, but this was a simple cloth, very dignified, a faded violet, dark violet, and it had wreaths at the bottom. Sort of funereal, really. I mean, it was very sad to look in the exits and look down and see that poor dusty old faded curtain there with the wreaths on it. Almost like a funeral.
You made me cry when you said goodbye. Is that a shame? My tears fell like rain. Said we'll part. Is that a shame? My tears fell like rain. Ain't that a shame? You're the one to blame. Oh well, goodbye. Although I'll cry. Ain't that a shame? My tears fell like rain. cry when you said goodbye. Ain't that a shame? My tears felt like rain. Ain't that a shame? You wasn't to blame. Oh well, goodbye. Although I'll cry, ain't that a shame?